The primary reason for this interfacing is not to receive things, is to be educated. You are within the framework of a massive enterprise, and God needs to educate you. There are so many resources available in the landscape. The operating system is the operating system of the grace of God. So much is in the expanse, is in the territory. And because of lack of education, our output is so little, because we want to escape intimacy and just speak in tongues away. Meanwhile, the Bible went deep to reveal to us the kind of relationship that Moses and God had. It was not formal. It was a friendship. And that was the only way it could be for Moses to be comfortable in God's presence, so that God can educate him. It was obvious subsequently that Moses had learned the ways of God. What school did he go to? A school of intimacy. That's where God came to teach him his ways, teach him how he operates. If we go through this congregation and we administer a questionnaire, you might be afraid at our level of ignorance of the God that we claim to serve. Level of ignorance. If you are not used to the protocol of intercourse, you will not learn nothing. You can keep speaking in tongues for so many years, and the issues around your life that limit your possibility are still going to be there. But when you begin to learn from the Lord, he wants to educate you. Please help me tell your neighbor, he wants to educate you. He wants to educate you. So we are running on a covenant that affords us the blessedness of access. And the Lord spake unto Moses as a man will speak unto his own friend. You will think that when the mighty God shows up and he wants your attention, you will think what he will bring will be very serious. Then he will tell you about your impatience. And for the next 2 months, it's locked in your head. Impatience, impatience, impatience. It will take you that level of dealing for you to now begin to see the things that leak out of your life just because of impatience. Then you will not find out that there's something called anxiety. And whatever situation that opens the door to anxiety, anxiety begins to manipulate your soul. And at the end of the day, anxiety will lead you to a point where it opens the door to the spirit of infirmity. Then eventually you find out that the reason why you were afflicted was not because of the situation that opened the door to anxiety. You were afflicted because of anxiety. He comes to give you lectures, and his lectures are prophetic. When he begins to teach you about fear, how that you should not fear in January, just know that there's something going to happen in June. You have no possibility of escaping the things that will happen in June if you don't take the lectures that he brings to you in January seriously. So the challenge with Adam was that Adam left school. And so when the instructor came to teach, he said, Adam, what? Where are you? You have not been in school. That's what I'm saying. You've been out of school. And the teacher came with the teaching aid, came with the projector, came with everything to begin a lecture, and the student had eloped. And for a long time, many of us have not reported to school. So you just started life on like a conveyor belt. And there are several deep things you should have picked up in simple encounters with God that you don't have. So when the storms come, they reveal your depth. Because it is your level of intimacy that is going to be equivalent to your level of faith. If you don't know God for God's sake, how can you believe him? Where art thou? Please help me tell your neighbor. It's the same question the Lord is asking this evening. Where art thou? Where art thou? You left school, left training, and you're on the field running naked. He knows that the next time you meet with the devil, you are going to crash land. And there are so many intensive care units now because people took off without any debt. And so Jesus has to run clinics to rehabilitate so many people. And the Lord spoke. This thing that is written in this one scripture, it will take you some time before you get to this school, even with the Holy Ghost in your heart. Because that person, that man, that woman that is so eager to rush and run away, you don't deliberately schedule an appointment with God. It doesn't matter how where you walk in Zenith Bank. Pastor John, you worked in Zenith Bank for many years. Do you guys work on Sunday? You don't work on Sunday. So it doesn't matter your work schedule. It is compulsory for you to attend school where he comes and speaks to you face to face. That school, you are the only student in that school. God has the facility to run Zoom lectures for only one student. He doesn't need to gather us as a community because your own curriculum is consistent with your calling. It's specific to you. It's idiosyncratic. It's not national. I came to challenge you this evening. What have you really learned from the school of intimacy? What do you know about yourself? What do you know about your family? What do you know about the calling that God put in your family? Because every tribe has a grace. The sons of Issachar, the Bible says, were men that understood the times and knew what Israel ought to do. That was a family grace that was upon a people, and they knew it and they were walking in it. What do you know about the grace that was designed for your family? You've not been to school. So a lot about your identity has not been received. You are just trying out life with the five pebbles of stones that you have in your hand, hoping that one of the shots will bring the giant down. Let me give you an idea. Building intimacy with God is something that you do consciously, deliberately, and daily. It's conscious, it's deliberate, and it is daily. The first thing that I want to tell you about, first requirement, if you want to build that structure in your life, because the reason for the metaphor of the tabernacle of Moses is that God wants you to engage him personally and intimately. If you're going to have an intimate relationship with God, the first thing that is needful for you to do is to discard a certain kind of haste that is part of the fall that is locked in your soul. When we call for a prayer meeting, have you noticed? You have not noticed. There's a haste in your soul. All right? You will need to murder that haste. You need to kill it. That haste is one of the strands of the fall of man, because since man became a rebel, he doesn't want to stay in God's presence. He moves out of God's lair. So there's that haste that is in your soul that you need to conquer. You need to conquer by subscribing to patience, waiting in the presence of the Lord. The second thing you will need to do is to learn how to speak to God. Now, for most of us, prayer is very formal. Our God that is in the third heavens, that sits as a luminary governor among the nations. Yeah. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. In this school, prayer is not that formal. Prayer is like talking to God. And one thing you must understand is that God does not talk much. God only answers much. So if you stop talking, you stop getting answers. You will initiate God's answers in this school. You initiate it. you initiate God's answers. Keep talking. As you walk on the streets, you are going to the office, you are taking a car, and if you are lucky, you are not driving. Keep talking. You see, your heart is in such a way that it can speak without a vocal expression. Your heart is designed like that. Your heart has a vocal cord, and you can mobilize your heart to begin to communicate with God and speak to God. You will find out after a while. Just keep doing it every day. Every day, a time will come when you try to, you set out, He will answer you. He doesn't speak much, and He only answers much. And you will need to develop a culture of perpetually speaking in order for you to come to that point where He's willing to begin to strip Himself before you. This is a very secret school, and only Moses gets to activate the possibilities of the school. And I'm praying that you will be that Moses. That Moses that will activate the possibilities that are locked up in a mysterious place called the tabernacle. It's accessible, but it's covered. It's enclosed. So the things happening inside are not up for everybody to view. Hallelujah. And it's like a boot. And only one person has very good accommodation inside, actually. So it's designed for your personalized engagements. So you will need to schedule your heart, program your heart to begin to communicate, talk to God. Start with your problems. That's a good place to start. Oh God, can you see? I am crying. Are you not seeing it? In that school, it's not formality. Everybody is real there. He speaks to Moses like a man will speak unto his. If you have a friend, Sister Cole, if you have a friend, won't you tell her your challenges, the kind of stuff? That's how the person will know that you have accepted her as a friend. You can open up. You can say, there is a challenge in the family. This thing I'm telling you is going to be, you have to cultivate. The next thing you will do when you learn how to speak to God, speak with God, is that you will learn how to practice obedience. The Holy Spirit is not powerful in a vessel where His authority is not acknowledged. You know, Jesus actually slept in the boat, and there was a storm. But Jesus was sleeping, and He snored. Oh! Hallelujah. So what releases Jesus for action is not danger. In the face of so much danger, Jesus was snoring. Oh! Now the reason why I brought that scripture is because He can sleep in your life too. And for many of us, He's been dozing. He has gone to even buy an orthopedic bed, because it's a good place for snoring. In order for you to engage Jesus, engage the Holy Ghost, you must make Him Lord. You must establish that He is worthy to be obeyed. So when you wake up in the morning, one of the things you tell God as you are going out is, I want to obey you. Meanwhile, in your office, there are very terrible people there. The only thing they need is spiritual arrows too. That is what they really need, to cut them down. But you know that there's a war front in your office. You just want to obey God. It's difficult to do it. There are terrible people there, but I want to obey God. And you go there, there's somebody that is on your neck, is willing to make you lose your temper every morning by 9:30 a.m. And then the first day you tell God, I want to obey you. That person will offend you by 9:30. And they will say, your father, your ancestor. Come on, son. Then you remember that, I said I wanted to obey you. Then you go into a corner, you repent. I say, Lord, you see, if you don't help me on these matters, I don't know what I'm capable of right now. But, and then tomorrow again, you tell Him, I want to obey you. A similar thing is going to happen tomorrow. But the way you responded the first day is not the way you will respond the second day. There's going to be an improvement, a little improvement. And then in 6 months' time, you'll be fully aligned. Anyone that wants to build anything with the Holy Ghost must take obedience seriously. You will check every area of your life and align it with the instructions of the Word of God. And you begin to practice the instructions of God deliberately. You will not do it in your dream. You will do it with your brain working. All of this that you are doing is alignment. You are gathering yourself together. The reason why those Israelites didn't want to take advantage of the tabernacle, the possibilities of the tabernacle, was they know that God won't leave any aspect of your life hanging out. Everything must be brought together and be submitted to the authority of the Christ. It is when that level of alignment begins to come into place, God is willing to speak. Say, this one has accepted my government. This one has accepted my rule. My command tower has been discovered by this one. So it's ready to speak out of the cloud. It's ready to speak out of the infrastructure. And you begin to hear his whispers. His whispers do not come necessarily as hardcore instructions. He will just speak like a passerby. If your heart has been angulated to function under his government, you will take his instruction. He will not say, "Hey!" No. I say, after you finish telling your husband about his grandfather, then he'll just pass by and say, I thought you knew better. He'll just pass by. If your heart is angulated to know his voice, you should break down at that point and begin to repent. But you see, he won't do more than that. Oh, you wake up one day on Monday morning and you want to head to the field because you found one yogurt at the palms. You bought 2 copies of yogurt and you want to head there, and then there was this faint feeling, fast, it will come only twice, very faint, very insignificant, it will pass on your heart twice. You are likely to ignore it, but that invitation was an invitation into pilgrimage in God. You are not likely to know about that flash if you have not prepared your heart for engagement. He will just flash. And the second flash is going to be weaker than the first one. Those that are wise understand his call, and they will now align and leave the yogurt. Then he will show you something greater than yogurt that day. Because the language that the immortals understand is the language of sacrifice. You have to let something go in order for you to enter into something in God. If you don't know sacrifice, you take everything, you take tom-tom, you take anything. If you don't know sacrifice, you will become old and your life will not count. He begins to teach you sacrifice. You just make a big breakthrough, and then he asks for 50%. Say, go and drop 50. And he will not say it twice. It will just pass. You will know he's him. He will give you the grace to be able to discern him when he passes. And he will come in a very faint manner. It is when you begin to practice obedience, deeper obedience, that the hold of that voice, the hold of that perception becomes stronger, becomes more, your receptacle becomes more articulated to. There's no one that became intimate with God that it just happened by accident. It's something that must be cultivated. Because God was, the tabernacle was there. He said, pitch it there. But he didn't come to invite people into the tabernacle. Is something, an initiative you need to take by yourself. The more you practice that level of fellowship and you are willing to obey, the more you are going to begin to discover that the voice of God is going to become stronger. He will test you in the area of money, test you in the area of submission to your husband. He will test you in the area of love to your wife. One day you just say, woman! Then he will pass at your back and say, don't talk to my daughter like that. And he'll just pass. If you are wise, go and look for a guitar and play and sing for her. Oh my God, you good for me. Oh, hey. Mama, you don't. Come on here, Miss Saki. May the Lord give you understanding. May the Lord give you. Get that guitar, that rusty one. And begin to. He will look at you and say, yes, you are making an effort. Yeah. You are beginning to understand the authority of my words. You are taking me seriously. Yes. And then he comes in the night. When you have done that and you have said your wife is happy, even she joins you in the dance. You don't know why you are even dancing. She doesn't know that he passed by your back and whispered. And then you finish that and you go to sleep. And then he comes with a lamp in the night and say, it is for this cause that I have called thee, that you will turn men from darkness to light, from the power of darkness unto the kingdom of God. He will never tell you anything serious until you can obey little things. It's primary school. That's where we learn ABC. Most of you took off like a tornado. You didn't attend primary school. You were a dropout. You were saying, where are you? Where are you? Meanwhile, you have joined UNILAG. You have joined. you have enrolled somewhere. Meanwhile, here is absent. You are a small man in a big body. When Satan shows up, you'll be no match. Because you have not yet learned the wisdom of God. You will take obedience seriously. Obedience seriously. Obedience seriously. You are the one paying the bills as a wife. You are the one, you know, paying the children's school fees. You renew the rent. You pay for the fixing of the car and all of that. And then your husband says something. Then you just remind him, hey! What are you? Are you? Then he will pass your back and he will drop it. He say, but I didn't teach you this one. I didn't teach you this one. If you are wise, you will change it to a song. Instantly. You just start singing. Start singing. Start. When he sees your effort to obey, your effort may not be good enough, but at least you attempted. He knows that your heart is angulated to acknowledge his kingship, his position, his government. You are in the right place. You are in the right place. And then he opens, and that's how grace comes. That's how grace comes. And when you find more grace, your husband in that state will be elevated just because of you. Favor will shine on him. The Bible says, and God remembered Abraham. You know, in the negotiation that Abraham did concerning Sodom and Gomorrah, Lot was the objective. Say, well, Lot stayed for so time. He must have evangelized. And I'm sure that he's a profitable man to the kingdom of God. So there must be at least 10 righteous people in the landscape. Meanwhile, there was a statement that Abraham made that caught God's attention. Abraham wouldn't have gone further with negotiation. He said, will you destroy the righteous and the wicked? He would have stopped there. But God didn't answer. Because he caught God there. But he went to negotiate. Say, okay, 50, if you find 50, if you find. Then he stopped at 10. So according to the negotiation, Lot was to be crushed with fire. Because Lot was not productive. It was just his household that was spared, that was righteous, that passed the test. But the Bible says that, and God remembered Abraham. This was not part of the negotiation that we're talking about. And God did what? He remembered Abraham because of his remembering Abraham, he sent deliverance to that was mercy. And the mercy was as a result of an intimacy he found with Abraham. Do you know that because of your own intimacy with God, God can look upon your husband and say, you will not die. You will not die. Because you are in this woman's life, you are in this my daughter's life, this my daughter that has honored me like this, you will live. You will live. Lot would have thought that it was the night vigil he engaged in that led to his deliverance. But only have my mercy. The Bible said that it was Abraham that God remembered and sent redemption to Lot. There are so many things that God does for an intimate fellow. Prayer is on three levels. You can pray to God as Father. You can engage God as a judge. You can also engage God from the standpoint of friendship. These are the three levels of prayer. And when you are engaging God as a friend, there are many rules you break. Many rules. Many. You will hear people like Abraham say, if I found favor in your sight, is intimacy is a currency for negotiation. If I have found what? Favor in your sight. These are men that have discovered the technique of how to move the hand of God. Where are you? Where are you? When you learn obedience and you are willing to make an effort when God rebukes you, it means that you honor him. And when it is proven beyond doubt that you honor God, then God will see the way your attitude towards the things he sends you to do. Are you with me?